Κυρίες και κύριοι, καλή σας μέρα και πάλι από το Ζάπιο με ένα πραγματικά νέο αλλά πάρα πολύ σημαντικό πάνελ με ένα πάρα πολύ σημαντικό θέμα που έχει να κάνει με την ειρήνη και τη συνεργασία στην νοτιοανατολική Ευρώπη. Θα ήθελα να συγχαρώ για άλλη μια φορά τους διοργανωτές, τον κύριο Τσομόκο και την ομάδα του, για το γεγονός ότι κατάφεραν παρά την πανδημία να γίνει και φέτος αυτό το φόρουμ. Λοιπόν, θα ήθελα τώρα να αλλάξω την γλώσσα στα αγγλικά. Peace and cooperation in the Eastern Mediterranean is the topic of this panel. We are all familiar with the problems the area is facing. Tremendous migration pressures threatening the political stability in Europe, open conflicts such as in Syria, Libya, and as we speak in Israel and Palestine, and very serious disputes on territorial waters and rights. The question is, within which context can we deal with these challenges? We Europeans, as we all know, believe in the rule of law, and of course, in the rule of the international sea law. The problem is that not all the parties and not all the countries involved in the area accept this rule. And the question addressed to this panel is what we can do. If there is any other framework or tool to deal with these problems, how can we influence the countries which do not abide by the rule of law to do so and cooperate in order to reach just and steady solutions? This is a short introduction. In order to answer to these very challenging questions, we have an amazing panel here. Let me welcome our host, the Minister of Foreign Affairs of Greece, Mr. Nikos Dendias. Welcome, dear Minister.
Thank you for inviting me.
Λοιπόν, let me invite Mrs. Arancha González Laya. She is the Minister of Foreign Affairs of Spain. Welcome. Best regards from Athens, dear Minister.
Kalimera Maria, it's great to be with you, even if only virtually.
Kalimera, Kalimera, thank you very much for the Greek opening. Λοιπόν, let me welcome Mr. Nikos Christodoulides. He's the Minister of Foreign Affairs of Cyprus. Καλή σας μέρα, Υπουργέ.
Kalimera, and thank you very much for the invitation and the opportunity.
Let me welcome Evarist Bartolo, the Minister of Foreign Affairs of Malta. Best regards from Athens, dear Minister.
Best regards. We're seeing too much of ourselves on the screens. It's not good for our health. We should meet.
We'll try to fix that. Λοιπόν, and let me also welcome Mr. George Katrougalos, Professor Katrougalos, member of Hellenic Parliament, and he used to be the Minister of Foreign Affairs 2019. Welcome, Professor.
Καλημέρα, Maria. Many thanks for the invitation. Good morning to everybody.
Να είστε καλά. Λοιπόν, we have 45 minutes at our disposal. I suggest each of you start with an opening, let's say, an introduction of 4 or 5 minutes. This gives us some time to have an interesting discussion, 2 or 3 questions. And I would like, by giving the floor to our host, Minister Dendias. Dear Minister, the floor is yours.
Thank you. Thank you for the invitation. Thank you for the opportunity. Thank you also for bringing me into a discussion with very distinguished guests, my friends, the foreign ministers of the Kingdom of Spain, of Malta, of Cyprus, Nikos, but also with Professor Katrougalos, who represents the opposition, but also has a deep knowledge on the international affairs and on the region. Well, you have asked a very basic question. How we can address the issues of our region? Is there any other way than international law and international law of the sea? On these, one could give 2 answers. One is a very short answer, one-word answer.
Yeah.
And that answer is no, there is none. But in order to explain why there is none, one has to try to go through a rather longer answer, which is So you will allow me to make use of the 5 minutes allowance I have.
Of course.
Well, there are many people and politicians and analysts in the world that think that the center of gravity has moved towards the Pacific now. But yet again, even these analysts and politicians understand how important is Eastern Mediterranean for the balance of the world. Eastern Mediterranean is a trade route, is an energy route, is also an area in which all ancient civilizations took place around this area. And as you said in your opening remark slash question, it is of profound importance. Migration is a world issue that needs to be discussed. Many conflicts persist under the region for decades, some even for centuries. Just days ago, we have this again, the situation in Palestine, between the Palestinians and Israel. We have the situation in Libya. If you will allow me to say, the Gulf is right next door, Yemen is right next to us, Iran is right next to us. And also, we should not forget that the Eastern Mediterranean is the only route towards the Black Sea.
That's true.
And then we have Ukraine, we have Crimea. So we have all sorts of problems.
We're in the middle of a turmoil.
Unfortunately, and I'm always, when discussing with my fellow ministers in the Council, in Brussels or in Luxembourg, I'm always saying, we're not blessed to be Luxembourg. We are Greece. And fortunately or unfortunately, apart from the huge and important tradition, there's always problems around us, many problems around us. So, in order, what Greece is trying to do? Greece is trying to do to persuade all the neighbors in the region that unless we found rules with which we could address problems that were here, are here, and are going to be here, there's no way forward. And rules, we cannot invent them. The rules are there. And the rules are international law and international law of the sea. That's what it is. And I'm happy because very many countries around the region, be it the countries of the Gulf, be it the countries of the Balkans, accept this thinking. Of course, there are exceptions. Unfortunately, very important exceptions. Very important exceptions for us, very important exceptions for the world all. Turkey is a proud example of exception. Yet again, I believe that we will continue trying, and that's the only way forward. But that's something that will come up during our discussion. So my short answer is no, there's no other way, and I gave you the long answer why that is that.
Okay, there is no other way. Let's find the way to follow this way or enforce this way at the end of the day.
We believe in the power of persuasion.
Yeah,
it takes more time, but I think it's more stable in the end of the day.
Thank you very much, Minister, for your opening remark. And let's give the floor now to the lady minister, the lady of our discussion. Let me give the floor to the Minister of Foreign Affairs of Kingdom of Spain, Mrs. Arancha González Laya. If I pronounce it well, is González or González? How should I...
You're doing it great, Maria. You're doing it great. It's perfect the way you did it. Let me start by saying that the Mediterranean can be and should be our area of shared prosperity. But we also need to make sure that we feel it's our common responsibility to deal with what is happening in this region, and that whatever happens to one of the countries in this vast region should concern every country in this region. And if we had any doubt, painful situations like we've seen in Libya and a more recent one, the one that we're seeing unfolding before our eyes between Israel and Palestine, is a stark reminder that this is not just a matter for one country or for two countries, it's for the entire region that this has to matter. In answer to your questions, I would want to make three observations. Number one, If we want to manage better the stability, the peace, the progress in this region, we need rules, we need institutions, we need frameworks that are going to anchor behavior in institutions and in rules, that we are going to avoid unilateralism, which is a disease that unfortunately is a little bit too spread, not just in our region, but around the world. This is where institutions like the Union for the Mediterranean that we've created in order to ballast and to organize Pacific coexistence in our region is so important. The second observation I would make is that our approach has to be one that starts from the interdependence between our nations. We are not independent. We are not dependent either. We are interdependent. Whatever happens to me has an impact on others, and whatever happens on others has an impact on me. We are bound by our economic ties. We are bound by the realities of climate change. We are bound by the impact that migration has, irrespective of where the migrants, at which door the migrants knock. So it's this reality of interdependence that requires also basically a co-responsibility. And this is the approach that, in my view, we have to use and exercise. The third point I would make is that, of course, the Mediterranean is a matter for Mediterranean countries, but if we want to address the issues affecting our region, we also have to work with partners outside our region. If we talk about the Mediterranean, we need to work with African countries. What happens in Libya matters for the Sahel, and what happens in the Sahel matters for the entire African continent. If we are talking about the Israeli-Palestine conflict, we obviously need to talk to regional powers like Gulf countries or like Iran. And if we are going to address the stability in the region, we need to also discuss with countries like the US, like Russia. So partnerships will be essential also to more peace and stability. So, Maria, in a nutshell, framework, rules, institutions, number one. Number two, it's interdependence. So let's do it in a responsible manner. And number three, partnerships. This is what I would want to raise in answer to your questions.
Thank you. Thank you, Your Excellency. I will carry on with the discussion and the questions later. Lipon, let me give now the floor to the Minister of Foreign Affairs of Cyprus, Republic of Cyprus, τον κύριο Νίκο Χριστοδουλίδη. Υπουργέ, ο λόγος σε εσάς.
Thanks, Maria. Let me first of all start my remarks by stating that I'm encouraged by the title of this panel, Peace and Cooperation in the Eastern Mediterranean, both because I really believe it is appropriately sets the tone for what I briefly wish to outline in my introduction, but also because it is indicative of the fact that the storyline for the Eastern Mediterranean is not static. It is changing, and in recent years it has changed, in my opinion, radically. And I will try to substantiate this claim. The predominant narrative in our neighborhood has been that it is a region of turmoil characterized by conflict, its stability constantly threatened and hanging by a very delicate threat. A region whose stability is important not only for the countries of the region, but also for the European Union, for the rest of the world, which has often seen a spillover effect from the region. And while I'm not by no means making the case that we have completely turned the page to this negative storyline, and tragically the events unfolding in the last few days in our neighborhood are a gloomy reminder of that fact, we can also not overlook some of the remarkable steps that have been taken in the region in the opposite direction. That while this narrative of turmoil unfolds, there is a parallel, radically diverse narrative, which in my opinion could reverse the predominant narrative of turmoil. It is a narrative of like-minded countries in the region with an exclusively positive agenda, and I fully agree with Arancha, without excluding anybody, coming together to promote the vision of cooperation, peace, and stability in the region. It started a few years ago with smaller yet bold steps, triggered initially by the discovery of the potentials, the energy potentials of the region. These discoveries brought together countries of the region, guided, and I'm coming to the point that very correctly Nikos did, guided by international law and good neighborly relations to delimit their seas. It's Greece, Cyprus, Israel, Jordan, Palestine, Egypt came together to form these regional cooperations, always maintaining their positive and inclusive agenda. And it is very important that they have expanded thematically to cover areas such as security, environment, health, having in mind the challenges from the coronavirus, research and innovation. Their added value has been, and this is very important, acknowledged by other countries, and its format has been expanded to include UAE, the United States, France, Italy, even the European Union in some cases. And I think at this time, at this moment, that the pandemic has pushed states to insularism and away from multilateralism, countries of the region have gone the other way. They have looked to these minilateral, as I call them, structures to address the pandemic together through cooperation and synergies. The deliverables of these regional cooperation are clear. Just to mention the importance of the formation of the Energy Forum in Cairo, with the participation of seven countries of the region. For sure, all these developments are creating a dynamic that is certainly not linear, I would say, but which is unmistakably there and which we must continue working and investing. And the momentum could lead, and we really believe this is our vision for this region, to the establishment of a regional organization for security and cooperation with the participation of all countries of the region. I'm repeating this, nobody is excluded from working together in the region in order to face the challenges, but also take advantage of the possible opportunities of the region. Peace in our region, just to use a Greek word, is not an oxymoron. And I say this fully cognizant of the fact that I'm a foreign minister of a country that has a political problem. It requires from all of us vision, political will, and it is possible if all countries in our neighborhood, in our region, realize that geography cannot change. Thank you. Thank you.
Let's see how this can be done. Thank you. Thank you very much, Minister, Your Excellency. Ευχαριστώ, κύριε Χριστοδουλίδη. And let me give you the floor now to Malta. Let me welcome again Evarist Bartolo, Foreign Minister, Minister of Foreign Affairs of the Republic of Malta. Please, the floor is yours.
Thank you, Maria. Thanks for this invitation. It's, the title, the theme is very, very important because existing disputes in the Eastern Mediterranean will not be solved by force. They can only be solved by peace and cooperation. These disputes require more than ever dialogue and negotiations. In recent months, we have seen hopeful signs to a return to open dialogue and to break out of our comfort zones. The Bible exhorts us, perhaps it's a bit too much what it expects us to do, to love our neighbors as ourselves. We know how difficult this is, even among neighbors within the same block of apartments, let alone when neighbors are countries with divergent interests and a long history of conflict and mutual distrust. In The Narcissism of Small Differences, Sigmund Freud tells us how communities with adjoining territories and close relationships are especially likely to engage in feuds and mutual ridicule because of hypersensitivity to the need to stress differences rather than similarities, what divides rather than what unites. The situation becomes even more complex when there are other differences that are big. all the states involved in these disputes, Greece, Cyprus, Turkey, Egypt, Libya, Israel, Palestinians, and beyond, have to patiently persevere to find ways forward through dialogue and negotiations, however difficult, without humiliating each other. Our role as friendly neighbors is not to add fuel to the fire, unless our agenda is to exploit these differences for our ends. There is not one single issue, from COVID to climate change, to energy exploitation, to immigration in the area, which can be solved by one country alone. We are condemned to solve these problems together or not at all. Appeals for dialogue and negotiations cannot be dismissed cynically as being naive. Even a hard-nosed realist like Foreign Minister Andrei Gromyko used to say, better 10 years of negotiations than a day of war. And as Robert McNamara tells us, learning from the terrible lessons of the Vietnam War, you've got to communicate with your enemies. Both sides made mistakes. Millions of people were killed because we both missed opportunities. He said that in hindsight, nuclear war was averted in the Cuban Missile Crisis because both the Soviet Union and the United States leadership, who took the ultimate decisions to de-escalate and find compromise, managed to put themselves in each other's skin. Within the leadership on both sides, there were those who wanted war and saw compromise as a weakness. Had they prevailed, nuclear war would have ensued. Learning from our history is necessary, although we don't do it enough. Looking at our mistakes in hindsight is commendable, but if we want to work to make our world a bit better, or at least a little less terrible, we must also show foresight. The disputes and divisions in the Eastern Mediterranean and beyond are not on land or in the sea or on maps, but in the hearts and minds of all of us involved, our histories and traditions. All the states and communities in the Eastern Mediterranean involved in these disputes need somehow to be involved fully in trying to address these disputes and find ways of coexisting in a spirit of compromise. Compromise, not capitulation. All this must be achieved within an agreed common framework of rules and laws, and not where might is right. Is this dreaming with eyes wide open? But perhaps, is it not better to dream a bit than to rush into further confrontation with eyes wide shut to all the grave consequences that will follow such escalation? If we cannot love our neighbors as ourselves, is it not possible to find ways of living side by side without being in constant conflict and tension with each other? Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you, Your Excellency, for your presentation, for your opening remarks. And now let me give the floor to Professor Katrougalos, ex-Minister of Foreign Affairs. Dear Minister, the floor is yours.
Many thanks, dear Maria. Let me begin by saying that I fully share what Minister Dendias has said at the beginning. And not because Nikos is my friend, he is, but because Greece has a continuity in the fundamentals of its policy. We are a peace-friendly, a peace-seeking country, which always bases its foreign policy on the fundamentals of international law. Still, having principles is not enough. We must promote them. We must seek always concrete goals and achieve them. And therefore, I believe that our foreign policy was more active, more multidimensional than the actual one. And I'm going to explain to you what I mean. What we have tried to do was to export stability in the area. In the Balkans, it is clear what we have done, the Prespa Agreement. In Eastern Mediterranean, I'm referring to what the other friend of the panel, all friends, but a friend with whom I had a close cooperation, Nikos Christodoulides, has said. Together with Cyprus, we have developed a network of trilateral meetings with other countries, having mainly in the agenda the energy issue, the exploitation of the natural resources of the region, having always in mind international law and the law of the sea. The highlight of this effort was the political agreement between Greece, Cyprus, Israel, and with the political, let's say, embracement of the United States, which has been shown by the presence of Secretary of State Pompeo in Jerusalem, when the three states have decided to sign the agreement on the East Med pipeline. And the concrete institutional crystallization of this effort, as Nikos Christodoulides has said, is exactly the Cairo East Med Gas Forum, which comprises now 7 countries of the area. Is there an outcast? Is this a coalition against one country? The elephant in the room, Turkey. Is this a coalition of friendly countries against one hostile? No. The only precondition for any country to be part of this effort to have mutual cooperation in the area, the one and only precondition, is respect of international law and the law of the sea. For this reason, on the exact next day of this symbolical signature between the three countries and the presence of the United States, I have traveled to Antalya to meet my counterpart, Minister Tsavusoglu, with a single meaning. We want to have also cooperation with you, but just accept what must be the obvious prerequisite, law of the sea. And this is always the message of our country to Turkey. And by finishing, I think that more generally, the role of our country is to act as a bridge. We have a political home. This is the European Union. But our added value to our political home is exactly to exploit the fact that we have never been a colonial power, that we have excellent relations with all the countries in the neighborhood. We had important diaspora in the past in many of them. So we can act as a bridge of European Union with forces, great forces of the world, like China, like Russia, but also with the Arab world. So active and multidimensional policies must be the trademark of our diplomacy.
Thank you. Thank you, dear Minister. Okay, now we have 21 minutes at our disposal. I'll try to ask as many questions I can. So try just to be short and concise in order to have more time for Q&As. And let me start with our host, with Minister Dendias. I have to say that here in Greece, dear Minister, we all appreciated your presence in Turkey, your presence as the Greek Minister of Foreign Affairs. On the other hand, we saw the collapse of the Cyprus talks under the auspices of Secretary Gutierrez. And the question is, what is next? Are we in an impasse with Turkey now? Are we going to continue the effort with Minister Tsavusoglu? Are you going to meet him soon in the next, let's say, days, months? What is next?
Well, Maria, thank you for the question. The truth is, for any journalist, the challenge is to ask as many questions as possible, and for any politician to answer the less possible. So,
since I found you here, I put everything together.
So, well, that, as Nikos Christodoulides would testify, I will start with Geneva. It was not good. It was not good at all. And I have to say it was not good at all, regardless of the huge efforts of the Secretary General of the United Nations, Secretary General Guterres, who tried his best by far, because what appeared there is that Turkey and the Turkish Cypriots were beginning the discussion from a no-go. And what I mean by a no-go, not something that we or the Republic of Cyprus didn't like, that would not have been the problem. No-go regarding international law, no go regarding the United Nations resolutions, the Security Council resolutions. Turkey and the Turkish Cypriots demanded from the Turkish Cypriots, from the Greek Cypriots, from the Republic of Cyprus, and from Greece, to accept that the Turkish Cypriot community had a sovereign right. It was a sovereign entity, which is contrary to the United Nations Security Council resolutions. So although we tried all sorts of angles, the truth is that if this is a starting point for Turkey, if this is a starting point for the Turkish Cypriot community, then there is almost impossible to achieve something positive. What I keep as, nevertheless, as a hope, although a very small hope, is that the Secretary General will continue trying, and we will continue trying. And we will continue trying persuading Turkey and the Turkish Cypriots that it's worth unifying the island again, but within a certain framework. And that framework could only be the resolutions of the Security Council and international law, which really means a federation, a bicommunal, bi-zonal federation in Cyprus. There is no other way. As far as Turkey is concerned, of course, I will be meeting Mevlut Çavuşoğlu, whom I've never hidden. He's a friend of mine. I have invited him to come to Greece. In principle, he has accepted the invitation.
When is he coming?
Well, that's up to him to decide. There's always an open door for him in Greece, in Athens. Again, I told you, he's a friend of mine, apart from all other things. And I hope this will be a meeting which will prepare a meeting between the leaders, between Prime Minister Mitsotakis and President Erdogan. Because we have to find a way to resolve issues with Turkey. And if we cannot find solutions, at least we could find a way to manage our differences. What has happened in 2020 and in the beginning of 2021 is totally unacceptable. The total disregard of international law from Turkey, be it in Evros with the migratory flows, be it in southeastern Mediterranean, be it in the Aegean with the overflights over the Greek lines, is totally unacceptable. So we have to find a way. But always, the way has a framework. And the framework is international law and international law of the sea.
This meeting is going to take place anytime soon?
I hope sooner rather than later, because although what appeared to happen in Ankara was this that sort of open debate, in my humble opinion, this was useful, because everybody listened very clearly in a non-very diplomatic languages to the two opinions there. And I have to say, for anybody well-meaning, it was quite clear who was right and who was wrong. But yet again, I'm the Greek foreign minister, so I'm expressing my opinion. But I think it's good that everybody knows where the starting point is. But that does not mean that we cannot talk, that dialogue could not continue, and we cannot live together.
Thank you. Thank you very much, Minister, for your answer. Let me go to Spain now. And dear Minister, you have your own share of migration pressures, of territorial disputes. What do you think a solution can be, a national one or a European one? And if you face an aggression from a non-European country, will you expect solidarity from the European Union members? Which are your thoughts on that?
Well, first, I would say that the solution should be one that is negotiated, one that is the result of a dialogue and a compact between the parties, never unilateral. So what we've always said is that unilateralism is not the recipe to resolve issues like territorial disputes, maritime borders, migration flows. All of this requires a negotiation. This is what we have always maintained. We maintain this with our neighbors, with whom we also have to deal with a number of these challenges, and with whom we have an understanding that unilateralism is not the way to proceed. And this is where I would start this conversation. What we have made clear in the case of the Eastern Mediterranean too, is that unilateralism is the red line for not only for the neighbors, next door neighbors, or those more directly affected, like Greece or like Cyprus, as regards Turkey, but also for the rest of the European Union, and by the way, for the rest of the Mediterranean countries. So it's a question of method. The method has to be when there is a disagreement through a negotiation. This negotiation sometimes will be between the parties, through a dialogue, like Nikos Dendias is doing now with his counterpart, Mevlut Çavuşoğlu from Turkey, or it has to be mediated under the auspices of somebody else, very often the United Nations. This is what's happening in the case of Cyprus, or sometimes with the support of the European Union. But to me, what's important is that we never forget that when there is a difference, unilateralism is what we will never accept for Spain as a member of the European Union or as a member of the international community. Follow the very well-known path of negotiations and dialogues. It's more difficult, for sure, but at the end of the day, it's the only one that is acceptable and it's the only one that will provide a long-lasting solution. I mean, Maria, let me tell you, we also have issues related to maritime borders with our neighbors. We have them with Algeria, we have them with Morocco. We also have to discuss migratory flows with these two, but also with countries like Senegal or with Mauritania or with Libya. And for us, what has proven to work longer term is dialogue and negotiation over unilateralism.
Let me add something here. One is wondering, a European Union in sanction in Russia for her behavior against Ukraine, which is not a European Union country, while European Union is not sanctioning Turkey yet for her aggression against two European Union members. What are your thoughts on that?
Well, first, the European Union has adopted sanctions against Turkey. We have adopted sanctions against Turkish nationals, not against countries. It's the same with Russia. We don't take sanctions against countries. We take sanctions against nationals or governments or business people, sanctions that are targeted. We've done this in the case of Turkey too, as regards Libya, for example. Now, I think we also have to be mindful that there is a bit of a difference between Russia and Turkey in terms of neighborhood. And in the case of Turkey, a country with whom the European Union has a customs union, a country against whom the European Union has a process of accession to the EU, a country with whom Spain, Greece, Cyprus, as members of NATO, have a military and security alliance. This is why, in the case of Turkey, it's not that we agree with unilateralism, which we do not, and we've made it very clear, is that we probably exercise double and triple efforts at fostering dialogue and negotiations before proceeding with sanctions. But we've made it very clear that if dialogue and negotiations do not bear fruit, sanctions will be imposed. So let's say that the difference is in the efforts that we put, given the specificities of this neighbor, the efforts that we display at trying to fix the difficulties that exist through a negotiation or through a dialogue, but being very clear that at the end of the day, there has to be also a solution and that there will never be an acceptance of unilateralism.
Thank you. Thank you, dear Minister. Let me give the floor now to Malta. Dear Minister, your country has very important relationship with Libya for economic, natural security reasons and also historical reasons. What do you want to see happening in Libya? Nowadays, Turkey has troops there. Should they stay or should they leave? Just an answer. What is?
We are for a united Libya and a Libya run by Libyans. And for a small country like ours, which values neutrality, and we do not have any military or naval or air bases in Malta, we would like also the same thing to apply to Libya. It's in the interest of Libya to find peace and prosperity. Still, the situation is still very difficult. It's a bit better than before. It's still very fragile. And what needs to be done, first of all, as even as Arancha was saying before, Libya can only be secure if also Sahel and the beyond is secure, because the poorest borders in the south have to really be managed. At the same time, the foreign presence and the mercenaries present in Libya, there has to be a negotiation they must leave, because otherwise Libya will not prosper. It has to be negotiated, because one side distrusts the other. One side still thinks that if they leave first, the others will take an advantage. So this has to be negotiated through the 5+5 and one of the instruments of the Berlin process. But definitely what we need is that peace returns to Libya. It's not easy, because even the government of national unity at the moment, which has only 8 months for which to organize the next elections, is in a very difficult situation. A lot of demands from the people of Libya, because yes, we tend to think of Libya only in terms of source of immigration or geopolitically, but Libya, first and foremost, is the country of about 7 million people who are still suffering a lot. No water, no electricity, very little money in their hands, prices are high, fuel shortages. You know, a country that can be one of the wealthiest in the Mediterranean, the people are still, you know, having a very difficult life. At the same time, the government of national unity does not have a budget with which to start satisfying the demands. At the same time is running out. The foreign presence should have been dealt with at the end of January. We're 8 months away from the elections. Will the elections automatically deliver a better group of politicians to run Libya? So, you know, we really need to support them on the ground. And this is where I feel that as European Union, we are absent and we are very, very slow. While others operate on the ground, we just go there, give a press conference and leave, and we think we've done our bit. But if we really want to help Libya be run again by Libyans, we have to be on the ground helping with the daily basic needs of people now, because otherwise the situation can deteriorate again. And it will be a problem not just for Malta, it will be a problem for Europe. Even at the moment, the most vulnerable part of the southern borders of the European Union is actually the central Mediterranean. You know, where Malta and Lampedusa.
For your answer,
Lampedusa.
We have to thank you, because we have only 6 minutes left and I have 2 questions more. Λοιπόν, to Minister Christodoulides, dear Minister, even Senator Menendez here from Delphi Forum had said that Turkey is pushing for the annexation of northern Cyprus. On the other hand, we don't see any of the initiatives under in the context of the UN reaching a conclusion. What lies ahead? What is there?
Your question and commenting on some of what my colleagues have mentioned. First of all, despite our great disappointment due to Turkey's position from the recent UN informal meeting for the solution of the Cyprus problem in Geneva, we stand ready to put our commitment to the test on the negotiating table, ready to engage constructively always within the framework of the UN Security Council resolutions on the Cyprus problem, ensuring that a reunited Cyprus is a function of viable European Union member state. And this is going to be an asset for the European Union and the region also. A solution within the UN framework and based on the EU values and principles, it will lead to a win-win situation, win-win scenario for all. Cyprus, Turkey, Greece, the European Union, the international community, the region that we are working and we want to to have good news. The status quo in the island cannot be the solution of the Cyprus problem. It's going to be the West development for all parties involved, for the European Union, for the region. Allow me to comment on two issues that Arancha very correctly mentioned about unilateralism. We cannot have solutions through unilateralism. The only way is negotiations. Let me remind you that we ask Turkey, since it feels so confident with its position, to start bilateral discussions for the delimitations in the north of our exclusive economic zone. We did the same with Israel, with Lebanon, with Egypt, using international law, using the 1982 UN Convention on the Law of the Sea, and we are ready to do it with Turkey. If they don't want to discuss bilaterally with us, we ask them to go together in the International Court in Hague in order for the court to decide. So if they feel confident with their positions, they can choose either bilaterally or let's go to the court. Another point that I would like to make, and I think it is very important, especially for the European Union, we cannot have an a la carte application.
We have only 2 minutes left.
Law. International law is there. Law. It's clear. It has to be applied for all issues. Thanks, Maria. Thanks, Maria.
Thank you. Thank you very much, Your Excellency. 3 minutes left, and I would like to give the 2 minutes to Professor Katrougalos, and after 1 minute to Minister Dendias for a conclusion. Please, the floor is yours.
Well, I said before that we have an agreement with the government regarding the great principles of our foreign policy, because they are not for the moment, they are permanent. But do we have a concrete strategy in order to promote these goals? And this is not a problem just for Greece, it is for Europe. For instance, Turkey, when it infringes international law, when it has occupation forces, not just in Cyprus, but also in Syria and Iraq, mm-hmm. it is not a Greek problem, it is a European problem. And does Europe respond accordingly? Unfortunately, other colleagues have said it. Often Europe does not speak with one voice, and when it does, this voice is not strong enough. So, to give a concrete example, what Greece could and should do. In June, we're going to have the appraisal of the Turkish reaction to what the European Union has incited it to do. If it does behave in an offensive way, we must have sanctions. If it wants to respond in a positive way, and what Turkey demands, upgrading the customs union, we could go for that as European Union, but under one condition, that Turkey accepts to send to The Hague the difference it has with Greece regarding the economic maritime zones. Not accept our positions. We do not demand that, but sent it to the court that the international community considered this as the solution, the arbiter for that. And I'm finishing with one phrase that could be, let's say, a new version of Helsinki policy, but without the internal contradictions and problems that this policy had. And it is a field that we can work together with the government.
Ευχαριστώ πολύ τον Υπουργό, τον κύριο Κατρούγκαλο. Λοιπόν, συμπέρασμα, in conclusion, όπως λέμε και σε άπτα στα ελληνικά.
Well, I think it could be said that what we have all agreed is that there is a way. Mm-hmm. There is a way for the East Mediterranean. And this way is to base our discussions and to base our dialogue on international law and international law of the sea. Mm-hmm. And this is the way forward. And I think Greece, regardless of government, is doing exactly that and is becoming a bridge between Europe, Middle East, and the whole region. Thank you so much for the opportunity. And also I have to thank the Delphi Forum and Mr. Tsomokos for organizing this within the pandemic. Even this is a great achievement.
Thank you. Thank you, dear Minister. I would like also to thank Spain, Malta, and Cyprus. Best regards from Athens. I would like to thank Minister Professor Katrougalos.
Many thanks.
Minister Dendias και βεβαίως τους διοργανωτές, τον κύριο Τσομόκο και το Delphi Economic Forum για μια πραγματικά πολύ ενδιαφέρουσα κουβέντα που είχαμε. Σκητάλη τώρα στον καλό συνάδελφο, τον κύριο Έλλης και έχει προσκεκλημένη του την κυρία Ντόρα Μπακογιάννη. Να είστε όλοι και όλες καλά. Yeah.